I got the scholarship to Cape Town, where there was the professor of physics, it was R.W. James, and I was taken on to do an MSc in physics. It was because there was £20 a month, was a lot of money of those days, in return for doing an MSc and also demonstrating in physics classes. But because I hadn't learned much physics at Wits, notwithstanding I had a degree, I went to all the second and third year lectures, and it's like system mechanics is really quite quite advanced. But James had been, R.W. James, very lucky to find him. I didn't know who he was, but he was a professor of physics. And he'd been a colleague of Bragg, Lawrence Bragg, who created X-ray crystallography. And he'd come out to Cape Town in 1937. I think in those days, people would go to Cape Town or Melbourne and so on. It was all part of the cycle of, well, you might go to Cape Town, that was as far away as you might take professorship in Nottingham or something like that. It's all part of the, what was the Commonwealth? Yeah. It wasn't called the Commonwealth then, it was called, it was called the Dominion. Yeah. Basically, it was the Commonwealth. So from James, he was an excellent lecturer, excellent. And he taught a great deal of optics, and I learned a good deal of optics, which again later stood me in good stead. But there was a lot of things like birefringence and ellipsoids and things of that sort, which, and they were good experiments, which I enjoyed.
Did the MSc involve research?
Yes, it involved research. Yeah. It was supposed to be it was either a two-year course, mostly did in 2 years, I did in 1 year. So my research was in X-ray crystallography. James had set up some, they were working on structures of organic compounds. The main line was to work on molecular complexes, and there were some interesting problems there, but they were already, people were already involved in them, where you get two molecules which don't interact, but they crystallize together, and there's quite a lot of, often they're quite incommensurate, so you get extra spots in the diffraction patterns, some quite interesting bits of geometry, how they line up. But I was given the problem of para-chlorobromobenzene, a very simple molecule, which somebody had crystallized and had reported a rather strange thing, because it looked as though the space lattice was indeterminate. So I was given that as my MSc thesis. It was great fun because the X-ray sets were pretty primitive. There were X-ray tubes were bought, but the voltage, the 40,000 volts, were homemade. And what you had to do was to set the voltage. You had two spheres, and you moved them together till you got a spark. And you measure the relative humidity, and that from that, from the tables, you could work the voltage. And it was, there was no such thing as safety devices, but the windows were always kept shut with bar. And I said, why? Because occasionally one of my predecessors had touched one of the spheres and been thrown across the room and nearly broke the window and would have fallen out, which was on the second floor. Yes. So it was that. But I did that for my MSc and solved the structure of, and it turned out to be a structure in which the molecules, para-chlorobromine, chlorine at one end of a benzene ring and bromine at the other. And so they sat, they could sit in random orientation. And so it was a bit of a surprise in those days, but it got published in Nature in 1947. This was my first publication.
James gave lectures in crystallography?
No, that was you learnt at the MSc course. The MSc course was mostly electromagnetism, relativity, a bit of wave mechanics, not much quantum mechanics. But during that year, I attended, and later on, I attended lectures in applied maths, where there was some Hamiltonian dynamics and a bit of quantum theory and so on. So I always went to lectures. I always attended lectures. And then they were introducing PhDs in Cape Town at the time, and so James said, "Why don't you stay on and do a PhD?" So I did a PhD, I started it, And I worked on the structure of a molecule called triphenylene, an organic rather. It's four benzene rings fused together, one in the middle and three on alternate sides of the middle benzene ring. I don't know what the interest was, but it was the, I should say the para-chlorobromobenzene was pretty tricky to handle because it evaporated all the time. And I had put it, I actually discovered how to keep it. They didn't have glass capillaries at the time. But what I did was to get hold of the capsules that you get pills in, the plastic capsules. You had to have something which would keep the vapor pressure. And so I mounted them in these things, and James thought it was very ingenious because I could get x-ray pictures. So that's what I forgot the point of it all. People weren't able to get decent pictures of para-chlorobromobenzene, so I managed to do it. So it proved they didn't evaporate well under vapor pressure. So it proved I could actually do something experimental. Well, I'm often regarded as a theoretician. So then going back to triphenylene, doing this PhD, I had a grant, a small grant. And I actually introduced a new method of trying to solve the crystal structures, which was to calculate what were called molecular structure factors of Fourier transforms. And by calculating the Fourier transform, all done by hand, of course, on Beaver's lips and strips, I calculated the transform of one molecule, and then I worked out possible positions in the lattice. And that changes the interference function, which changes the sampling of the molecular transform. And that was new. Nobody had done that before. And actually, I didn't get the structure right. It was out by, it was so powerful that I got the orientation absolutely right, which accounted for most things. But I had a undergraduate students who was, there was an undergraduate project, and he was assigned to me. And he was measuring the intensities. I had developed a method of measuring intensities because people used to read them off a strip, but I discovered that the astronomers, there was a good observatory in Cape Town, measured their stars' charts with a densitometer, which we didn't have in the physics department. So I adapted the densitometer to make measurements of X-ray diffraction. That's hardly ever being done at the time. I know that Bragg himself at the Cavendish was making waves of densitometers. This worked very well. In fact, it was so, I got such accurate intensities collected on the Weissenberg camera that you could see the hydrogen atoms. So this all impressed James, and James thought I should go to Cambridge.